morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to Mount Crory Church of Faith on this beautiful sunny morning, even though it's a bit nippy outside. That's why you can wear all these green sweaters today and not be too overly hot. But happy St. Patrick's Day to all of you. And anyway, I have a number of announcements to share with you today, because last week was busy, this coming week is busy, and then the week after that's Holy Week, and that will be busy. So we are collecting, as you know, peanut butter for Haiti again this year. This is the actual last Sunday that you'll be able to bring the peanut butter. If you did not bring it today and still want to contribute, you can get it to the office Tuesday or Wednesday, and I'll be talking about that in a moment. Or if you need to get it to us, either by calling me or calling Nancy, and we can make arrangements to get it. We just have to have it by Friday, because on Friday is where we take it to the drop-off. So if you can get that in as you can. Also, this afternoon is the final day of the Christian Clearinghouse garage sale at Brinkman's on East Sandusky Street in Findlay. Yesterday was a big day, and they're 8:30 to 4, and then today it's 1 to 4. And it's their bag day, so you can get a paper grocery bag and fill it for $10. And so you'll have people walking out with quite a few bags. So come on out and fill those empty spaces for that. And then this evening, don't forget, at 6 o'clock is the next Sunday evening Lenten service. This time it's going to be at Good Shepherd in Benton Ridge. And the speaker tonight will be Pastor Doug Kendrick. He's at Macomb. He's been a friend of mine. He spoke here a few months after I got here. And then, for those of you who attend the Sunday night live services, he was the one that was here, I think in the fall, where we sat up here and did the interview back and forth, his testimony about where he's been in his life and how God brought him from places of addiction and so on, to a point where now he's a pastor at a church. So he will be the speaker tonight, and I look forward to him. Those who are involved in Faithline Youth Group in Bluffton, that starts at 6:30 tonight at Bluffton First Methodist. And then coming Tuesday evening at 7:30 is the choir concert for Corey Rawson. That was rescheduled from last Tuesday when it was canceled because the director was ill, so they made it this Tuesday. And I told him, hey, look, I canceled a church meeting just so I could be there for the kids last Tuesday night. Now they move it to this Tuesday, and it's election day. And I'm working the polls at Gospel Fellowship. I'll be there, Mary Ann, to 5:30 in the morning till 8:30 at night. So I'm going to miss it. I don't know why they didn't consult with me first. But anyway, we had canceled that meeting last Thursday and still haven't been able to get it rescheduled, so we'll get to it. That's Pastor Parish Relations. We'll get to that sometime. But so speaking of the concert and the election, obviously I'm not going to be in the office any on Tuesday. Nancy plays some songs for the kids for the choir concert and may be going over to the school at some point during the morning to help rehearse with them. So if you have any need to come to the office, just please call first so you don't make a trip out there needlessly. And then we'll both be in there on Wednesday at regular time. Let's see here. That's Tuesday. Then on Wednesday, last session of our Lenten Bible study series at Bethel at 7 o'clock. A shepherd looks at the 23rd Psalm, so that will be concluding this Wednesday evening, so come to that. For those of you who are involved in Melody Circle at 11:30 on Thursday, the 21st, they're meeting at Arby's. And then on Saturday at the Weinbrenner Seminary in Findlay, at 7 o'clock, Rise FM is hosting a concert called the Unreal Tour. It has the group Unspoken, and it has the group Sanctus Real, who's been around quite a few years, and they've been in the area before. It's contemporary Christian music, good Christian music from the last, I think both of them been around for at least 20 years or so. So those are all general admission tickets. If you're interested, that's Saturday night. And then that brings us to Sunday, and it's Palm Sunday, and then off we really go. with the schedule. So in your bulletin, you will see actually printed on the face of the bulletin, the schedule for Holy Week. We'll be getting you more information about that. For those of you who watch online, the bulletin is posted on our Facebook page, and also that schedule is also in the newsletter, so you can take a look at that. And if I didn't do so already, thank you for those of you who are joining us on our Facebook live feed. We are so glad that you join us. And I know many of you join us every Sunday, and we're blessed that you do so, and hope that you are blessed likewise by signing in to us. Today's Noisy Change Collection Day back there, so you can do that. And then this week, on Tuesday the 19th, Grayson Fackler is having a birthday. Is he 13? I think he's about 13. But anyway, if you see Grayson, tell him happy birthday. I tell him happy birthday at the concert, but somebody can't go. And on Thursday, I lost that little, I found it. That little thing over there that protects it, so I'll try not to talk down to it right now. Merlin's having a birthday Thursday, another trip around the sun. Thank you, Merlin. Happy birthday to you. Any other announcements before we begin service today? If not, Nancy, will you prepare our tonight's worship? Thank you, Nancy. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the living God." This is the day when we rejoice in God's act of creation. Just as God decreed that Israel come together to worship God, so we too bring our praise and thanksgiving to the Lord and our God. And this is our Sabbath, when we rejoice in the resurrection of Jesus the Christ. We give thanks that once more God has brought us together, that we might be refreshed in Him. So peace to all who enter here, and blessing to all who go out from here on their way. In Jesus' name, let us pray. O God, who is greater than the most powerful forces in this world, enable us to be still and know that you are God. O Lord, who answers out of the whirlwind of everyday life, breathe in us your Holy Spirit to strengthen, comfort, and guide us in the midst of the storm. O still small voice, speak to us this hour that we might become makers of your peace in our homes, in our communities, and in our world. And we pray all this in the name of the one who calmed the raging sea, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Will you please join us in our opening hymn today, In the Cross of Christ I Glory. It can be found on page 295. If you're using the hymnal, we're doing the first four verses. It will also be on the screen. Please rise in body or spirit. Continue in our worship, Lord, you are so precious to me, as found in the red praise book, number 3, or on the screen.
I love you. Yes, I love you.
Thank you. You may be seated. We've come that time in our worship service where we want to go to the Lord with our joys and concerns. I have several that I want to share with you, and then I'll open it up to those of the rest of you who may have something that you would like to add to it. First of all, obviously, we need to have front and center in our mind those who were affected by the storm, the tornadoes Thursday evening. And of course, we know and have seen the devastation down at Lakeview and Russell's Point and around Indian Lake community. And it breaks our hearts. Last we knew, there were three that were deceased and many others who were injured. And that doesn't even take into account the property damage, which was devastating in many areas of those communities. It's going to take a long time for them to recover. So continue to be in prayer for them as we, in the weeks to come, look for ways that we might be able to assist in some tangible way. But it also affected some of us, some of our neighbors here close to home. There were a number of homes that were, if not destroyed, badly, badly damaged. You saw one of them picture on the front of the Findlay paper yesterday that had the roof taken off. But also, very close to home, Rick and Janet Marshall, Merlin and Char's son and daughter-in-law, their home was, their property was hit and impacted as well. Had windows blown off, all the shingles taken off the roof. The roof remained intact structurally. They're not sure if they're going to have to replace rafters or not because they're not sure how much pressure lifted that off. But they've been able to tarp that, and the house is at least habitable, and they're able to stay there. But the barn ended up with a much more extensive damage. It lost half the barn. Some of you may have seen the video on WFIN that they had posted online. And with the half of the barn, a lot of the expensive farm machinery was heavily damaged, as well as a vehicle or two. Interestingly enough, and tornadoes are freaky this way, the other half of the barn remained intact, and there were some antique cars that were in there. Didn't touch them a bit. Go figure. But anyway, we offer praise to God that kept Rick and Janet safe, and not only them, but their daughter who lived in Bluffton, who doesn't have a garage, came out, and their son and daughter-in-law and the new baby, was it son or grandson? No, it's your grandson, his? Their son, your grandson, yeah, had gone out. And so all of them, the whole family was huddled together in the basement, thinking they'd get away from their homes and so that the tornado wouldn't end, so they go to the place and that's where it hits. So go figure. But God is good in that he kept all of them safe, so we continue to bless them and ask, lift them up in prayer. We continue to pray for Jonathan Kieran, Jenny's son, who's had some difficulty. As you know, he had a kidney transplant here a while back, and then he's had some other illness that they're concerned about having an adverse effect on that surgery. So continue to pray for Jonathan. Also continue to pray for Sue, and we give thanks for Sue Koontz. She had knee replacement surgery on Tuesday. It was successful. It was late in the day, so they kept her overnight, but she was home by 10 or 10:30 the next morning on Wednesday. So she is doing well and is in good spirits. Of course, John goes in on Tuesday morning for a replacement of his pacemaker. So continue to be in prayer for them. They have a lot going on between the two of them. So continue to lift them up. I also want to just lift up a prayer for my mother's first cousin, Pam Moyer. She's had a cascading series of health issues that landed her in a hospital, a very serious condition. They've determined that one kidney is completely gone and will probably have to be removed. The other's full of stones. And she has other health problems that have aggravated all of those. So continue to be with Pam. Lift her up in prayers. Are there others that you'd like to share this morning? Tim.
If you would keep Becky and Joe Reaponoff in your prayers. Their daughter, Katrina, she passed away waiting for a heart. This was going to be her second heart that she had received. She was a teacher at Bluffton Middle School.
Yeah, I did hear about that this morning over at the other church, and apparently she had been waiting on that transplant, and she even taught that day, from what I understand, and then went to the hospital that evening and passed the next morning. Those people in Bluffton schools, not only the teachers and staff, but the students, they've been through a lot in the last several years that you would hope that they wouldn't have to go through, but we find out that there's nothing that can insulate them from the world, but we can certainly come around them and wrap our arms around them. And so we'll continue to pray for all of those who loved and cared about Katrina, not only her personal family, her parents, and the rest of her family, but also her students and fellow teachers and support staff. Are there others? If not, will you please join us in our prayer hymn this morning, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross. It can be found on page 301 or on the screen. You may remain seated as we sing this. Gracious and merciful Heavenly Father, we come to your presence this morning with grateful hearts to be able to gather here in this sanctuary once again. We thank you for the signs of spring, despite the cool weather and the stormy weather that comes through. We thank you for the rain. We thank you for the buds on the trees and the flowers poking out of the ground and the greening of the grass. It's so refreshing to know that out of things that once seemed dead are springing back to life. It gives us so much assurance as we head into this holy week and in our lives even to come. Lord, we thank you for your watch care over us, that you have watched over so many who were affected by the storm this past Thursday. We thank you for your hand of protection over Rick and Janet and their family and the others who were impacted here in this county. Our hearts go out to those who have suffered so much down in the Indian Lake area and Lakeview and Russell's Point and those environs. We just ask your blessing on all those who lost loved ones in that storm. It happened so suddenly, and at one point an hour before, people are fine and alive, and an hour later, they're gone. It's hard to process. It's hard to take. And when you add the devastation of all the personal property on top of it, that's tough. So, Lord, they need your tender care. They need to feel your arms around them and give them comfort and give them peace and give them the hope that days will be better and that recovery can take place. We know that you're with them. We just ask that they be able to feel it and understand it. And Lord, as we're talking about those who've lost loved ones, we lift up the family of Katrina Rippenhoff, her parents, her family, her loved ones, all of those in the Bluffton schools, the teachers and staff and students of hers. That she was in school one day and gone the next, just as if a storm of its own making had come through. And that school system has been through so much loss over the last number of years. And so we just ask that your tender loving arms be around them as well. Give them comfort and give them peace. We ask your healing touch to be upon Jonathan and John and Pam. We ask that that healing be brought full measure and that they be fully healed if that is your will. And we certainly lift up John as he goes into surgery on Tuesday. We thank you for Sue's successful surgery and ask that her healing be brought to completion as well. We also know that we have many people in our bulletins that we've been praying for some time. We continue to lift them up to you, and we know that there are also unspoken requests on the hearts of those here in this sanctuary, those who are watching us online this morning. And we take a moment to lift those up to you now. Father, you look after us and care for us and provide for every need. And out of that need, out of those blessings that you provided us, we are able to give back to you. And as we came in this morning, we placed our offerings in the basket. We just thank you for the opportunity to do so. We know it's just a pittance of what you give us. But we ask for your blessing upon it, blessing upon those you gave. Help us to use it in a way that's pleasing to you. And most especially today, we are grateful for the gift of your Son, Jesus, and the sacrifice that he made. As this Lenten season continues and we prepare our minds and hearts for the coming days. Help us to be mindful of the price that was paid and the sacrifice that was made on our behalf. Lead us to the cross. Then lead us to the empty tomb. That we can, in confidence and assurance, understand that this life is only the beginning. And that you have so much more in store for us than we can ever imagine if we continue to put our trust and faith in you. And it is in the name of that Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray the prayer that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This morning I will be reading John chapter 12, verses 20 through 33. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. "Sir," they said, "we would like to see Jesus." Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant will also be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven. "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, "This voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die.
Thank you, Sarah. May God bless the reading of his holy word this morning. Forgot to share a couple things with you. The experience of Thursday night was one of quite interest to me. I was not here in Mount Corey on Thursday night. I happened to be in a greenhouse in Findlay on Thursday night. It's not the most substantial structure to be in when the sirens go off, and Marcia and Daryl Gallant were there too. It was the opening special event for the Christian Clearinghouse garage sale, and so yeah, that was kind of interesting. Also wanted to mention that the flowers for Easter, we're not ordering them as a group or having them delivered here. So if you would like to contribute a flower to decorate the sanctuary, go ahead and get your own and bring it here. And then, of course, you can take it home with you immediately after the service. And I have a couple of personal praises, too. Yesterday, or this weekend, my daughter and the two grandkids in Dayton made their first trip up to Cleveland and met their new cousin for the first time. And so there's some pictures there. I'm actually going to be going up to Cleveland on Friday to see her again. So God is good. Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Now, often when you hear someone mention having the talk, two things come to mind. For those of you who are invested in daytime television, some of the might think of the chat show called The Talk, women discussing various issues of the day. The only thing I will say about that is I hope and pray that you have other sources of information to educate yourself in some of those areas. The other, the talk somebody might think of, has to do with the sex talk, the birds and the bees that we may or may not have been a part of either as a child or as a parent. And let's face it, for those of us who are older, that probably is less likely to have happened. Those things just didn't get talked about back in the day. But that's not what I'm talking about here this morning. What I'm talking about is some real talk, some real conversation. Conversation and talk that's full of honesty. It's not sugar-coated. It's full of truth and facts. And we've all been called upon to be in difficult conversations before. Sometimes those conversations are between spouses regarding the state of their relationship or something that's going on that affects the relationship. Sometimes it's between a parent and child when they have to explain to the child why the answer to their question is no, and they really don't want that to be the answer. Sometimes those conversations are between an adult and their aging parents regarding their care or their living arrangements, or probably the most difficult of all, their ability to drive. Sometimes it's between friends about an addiction that one friend sees in the other, or a confession that one friend is making to the other of some kind, of some failure that they have been involved in. Sometimes those conversations are conveying the news of someone who passed away and the difficult conversation that is. And the list could go on and on about difficult conversations we may be called upon to have with someone, but when we're talking about real talk, real conversations, the three key elements to those are that we need to be truthful, even when sometimes the truth hurts. We need to have empathy and compassion and offer our assistance and our support wherever we can. And we need to like them for who they are and not necessarily for what they do, or what we may hope they become. In today's text, we have an example of some real talk. Some real talk between Jesus and his disciples. To an extent, some real talk between Jesus and his Father. And even by extension, between Jesus and us today. And it reminds us of the importance of being real. We need to be real with God. We need to be real with others and each other. And probably one of the most challenging, we need to be real with ourselves. Now here Jesus is doing just that. He opens up in this passage about the unfolding events with total honesty. He doesn't sugarcoat or throw up a facade about what is going to happen. And in this passage, Jesus is at one of his most authentic moments. And it all starts, the text begins with a description of these two Greeks. Now, we know that they have come to Jerusalem to worship at the festival, the Passover and the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, which means that if they're not Jewish converts, they at least are familiar with the Jewish customs, although they probably, unlike most Jews, aren't there hoping and expecting Messiah to come to rescue them from their oppression of the Romans. But they had heard about this person, Jesus, and they wanted to meet and talk to him. And so they approached Philip, who was from Bethsaida, which is up on the northeast side of the Sea of Galilee. And Philip, while a Jew, also had a Greek name. Philip is a Greek name, which is maybe why they approached him. Now, let's set the time frame for this. Understand that Jesus has just raised Lazarus from the dead. Now, you think all of his other miracles weren't exciting and word spread. When you start raising people out of a grave after 3 days, that gets people's attention, and that word spreads quickly, even in that day without internet. So people were hearing about this. And he had just entered Jerusalem on a donkey with throngs of people lining the roadway, waving their palm branches. And we'll talk more about that, obviously, next week on Palm Sunday. But these two Greeks, like so many people throughout the ages, clear up even today, make a very simple request. We would like to see Jesus. We'd like to see Jesus. Now, interestingly enough, while John found these two Greeks important enough to the story to have them make the request, they apparently weren't important enough to mention them again. So there's no record of whether that meeting ever happened. And there's no record of whether they were present during the discussion between Jesus and the disciples, although the text says that there was a crowd around. So they may have been a part of it, they may not have, we don't know. But when Philip and Andrew came to Jesus with this request, it began the talk, the real talk that Jesus had. And he began it with an announcement. Starting in verse 23, Jesus says, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." That's quite an announcement. The time has come. Think back to the very beginning of his ministry, when he was in a discussion with his mother Mary at the wedding in Cana. She was requesting him to perform his first miracle. He said, "My time has not yet come. It's not ready yet. His time has not come." Of course, she being a Jewish mother and he being her son, he did what she said. But now we are at the 3 years later, what we know to be the end of his ministry, and the time has come. It's time for him to be glorified. And he was referring not only to his death on the cross, but also to his resurrection and ascension that would come later. And skipping on down to verse 31, he once again says, "Now is the time. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now is the time that the prince of this world will be driven out." Now, who is the prince of this world? Well, Jesus is referring to Satan. I had a discussion just this week with somebody about how there's way too many people, and many Christians included, who downplay the figure of Satan. Kind of poo-poo it off. "Yes, I believe in God, but that's Satan." That's just kind of make-believe. They reduce it to some small character, some little man in a red suit with a pitchfork. And folks, the devil is content with that sanitized version of himself, rather than a non-threatening view of himself. He's okay if we don't take him seriously. That does not make him any less real. So here's some real talk, and here's some real truth. Satan is very real. He's very much at work in this world today, and you don't have to look far to see some of the impact of what he's doing. This is not just some symbolic reference that is being made. If he didn't exist, Jesus wouldn't have had to say that the Prince of Peace needed to be dealt with. If Jesus, our Christ, says he exists, that's good enough for me. and we've seen his power always, and we know that he is laying in wait to steal, kill, and destroy any sheep who strays from the Good Shepherd. And because the word was getting out about Jesus, and so many were coming and making such a big deal about him, the authorities were plotting to do away with him. And it was based on a couple of things. First, obviously, if they're looking to him, it's a threat to their power and authority. They also were concerned that all the commotion to do over him might catch the attention of the Roman occupiers, who were already concerned about a potential Jewish rebellion. And they were concerned that if the Romans felt threatened enough, they might launch a preemptive attack, putting both the temple and the people at risk. So it was just easier just to get rid of him. Certainly easier to get rid of him, the one person, than the Roman occupiers that they were dealing with. But he says that when he is lifted up, he will draw people to him. So one of the things that we need to understand is that for all who wish to see Jesus, whether it's the Greeks in this passage or whether it's us today, there's one place that we need to look. That's the cross. That's where we need to look. Christ understood that the only way to save our world was to go through that agony. Real talk, no sugarcoating. True Christianity is that. You cannot have Christianity and not talk about what happened on that cross. We must acknowledge our sin and our need for the cross. You see, because through that dark, violent, bloody chapter, we still can see God's love shining through it to us. And no matter the pain or the suffering or the challenges we face, Jesus is always right there. Because for most of us, we will never experience what he had to experience. You see, the cross is where Jesus defeated sin and death and the devil. It's where he defeated the ruler of this world. It's where he bore the judgment of the world. And it is here that he accomplished our salvation. It was there that he accomplished our salvation. Yes, his rising from the dead showed us he was alive and that he was truly the Son of God. But our salvation wasn't based upon the stone being rolled away. It was based upon his death on that cross made of wood. Because without that cross, Jesus knows that his mission will be in vain. You know, he went into this analogy about the seed and this principle of life through death, and that he had to die so that fruit could grow. Because he's telling his disciples, hey, look, I need to get out of the way, send the Holy Spirit to you, and then you 12 have your work to do because it's now your turn to go out and bear fruit. And he says, unless the grain of wheat falls, this can't be accomplished. This mission of mine can't be accomplished. Now, folks, when we're talking about Jesus on the cross, there are three things that happened there that we need to pay particular attention to. So once again, some real talk, some straight truth. First, the cross frees us. It's not our work. We cannot free ourselves. There's nothing that we can do. See, Jesus is showing us how to live once we're free. That's what his teaching is. But the teaching, his teaching didn't save us. His death did. The freedom of the cross, the freedom of the gospel was won on the cross. So what is the result? That we may belong to him, that we live under him in his kingdom, and we serve him eternally in eternal righteousness. Because he freed us, that is the result. We belong to him, we live under him, and we serve him for eternity in righteousness. Number two, Jesus' death on the cross brings us into his kingdom. We now belong to Jesus. C.S. Lewis said that there is no neutral ground in the universe. Every square inch, every split second is claimed by God and counterclaimed by Satan. So the question is, which kingdom do we live in? Do we live in God's kingdom or Satan? We're either serving God or serving our selfish desires in the ruler of this world. See, Jesus died on the cross to free us from our sin, to claim us for his own, and to transfer us from one kingdom to the other forever. It's his purpose. And he knew that. And yes, there was a passage where he says his soul is troubled. In the other Gospels, they talk about his prayers and agony in the Garden of Gethsemane. John more focuses here. He talks about his soul being troubled. Yes, shouldn't I just ask the Father to save me from what's going to happen? And he says, no, I can't do that. I can't do that because this hour, this thing that I have to go through is the very reason why I came in the first place. And if I don't do this and I don't go through this, then all this, it's been wasted. And the third thing, the cross helps us to bear the fruit of the kingdom while on earth. He died to give us the Holy Spirit so that we could be comforted, we could be strengthened, we could be encouraged. So all of us throughout said we wish to see Jesus. We wish to see Jesus. And we have to see him through the cross because it's only that way that we will ever see eternity in heaven. You know, Alistair Biggs, he is a pastor, been a long time up in the Cleveland area. And if you ever seen any video of him, he talked one time about how if we are standing at the gate of heaven and we're asked, why should you be let in? If we respond to that question by saying, well, I went to church and I did this and I did that and I did. If you answer in the first person, I, you've got it all wrong. Because there is nothing that we can do in and of ourselves. No matter how good we are, now how good we try to be, how good we think we are, it's not good enough. Only when we answer that question in the third person, it's what he did. It's what Christ did on the cross for me. That's why I should be allowed in, because he said I could come. So the question is, the invitation's open to everyone. He said we could all come. It's like the sign that John put on the marquee out front. It's a gift he's given. But have you opened it? And the sad, sad thing is, many, many among us will not. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son. We thank you for the sacrifice, the torment, the agony that he went through for us. Father, it's my hope and prayer that everybody hearing this message, whether they're in this building, watching online, whether it's this morning or any time after, have accepted that gift and opened it and know you as personal Savior. Because once we understand what you did gained us our salvation, that all the things that we do in our life for good is in response to that, in gratitude out of what you gave to us. So, Father, I ask for your strength and your courage for every one of us here to take that message of hope and that gift of eternity that you offer to everyone around us that we meet, to a world who so desperately needs to hear that message. And despite any slings or arrows that may throw in our way, give us the courage to never compromise your message to them. That we do it in a loving way, but we don't sugarcoat it, we give it with truth. Give us the courage to have those real talks that we must have. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. Will you please join us in our closing hymn this morning? Grace Greater Than Our Sin can be found on page 365 or on the screen. Please rise in body or spirit.
Our sin and our guilt, yeah.
And now, until we meet again, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.